Good evening, everyone. Good evening and welcome. My name is Joel Towers. I'm the Executive Dean of Parsons School of Design. It is a real pleasure to welcome you this evening to our At the Parsons Table with Frank Stella and Paul Goldberger. The At the Parsons Table series is an ongoing series of conversations and interviews with cultural luminaries hosted by Pulitzer Prize winning author and Parsons faculty member Paul Goldberger, who is the Joseph Urban Professor of Design and Architecture at the New School. The conversation series provides exclusive insights into the creative process and innovative thinking of artists, designers, and industry leaders, and has included such extraordinary luminaries as Frank Gehry, Ralph Lauren, Bruce Mao, Donna Karan, most recently Thomas Heatherwick, and we are thrilled to welcome Frank Stella. The table itself has a long history. Indeed, we built this one, the original Parsons table built in the 1920s in the Parsons Paris campus by students who were working at the time in our studios. And this one here was built in 2014, by Eric Foister, who's a grad of the Parsons Master of Architecture program. And in this case was built with something called plyboo, for all of you who know what that is. It's a plywood and bamboo combination with a soy-based formaldehyde-free adhesive and zero VOC paints, nothing they had in the 1920s in Paris at all. Jean-Michel Franck would wonder what we were building it from, I'm sure. But it is an important reference to the fact that the school and the times change, but the work has a timelessness to it. I'd like to thank many people for this evening, in part because we are here indeed due to Frank's extraordinary work, which hangs above us here on the stage, the painting called Deauville, and we will talk about that, I'm sure, this evening. But it came here through an extraordinary effort on many people's part, and I'd like to start by thanking Eric Stark and Sylvia Rocciolo, our curators for the New School Art Collection, who worked tirelessly to bring this work to the campus. It now joins works of many, many artists. There are seats, I believe, up here, which you can take. Many artists, including Orozco and Walker and LeWitt and Ligon and many others. And in this instance was a gift of the Fisher family, a very generous one. Of course, I'd like to thank President David Van Zandt for his leadership in making this possible, and Tim Marshall, who's here tonight, our provost, who really advanced the acquisition and indeed the negotiation of finding a space for this painting on the campus. The Art Advisory Group and the Board of Trustees supported the acquisition and its placement, and many others worked to make it possible. It's not so easy to get a painting of this scale on campus in the right place, but I think we found exactly the right place for it. Thomas Whalen, our Director of Facilities, helped with all of the engineering and the logistics. Peter Daniel of Primary Art Services and his crew worked as well on the installation, and many others. I read this list in part because both Sylvia and Eric would want me to do so, but because it also is represents what it means to this community and how many people participated. So without further ado, I am pleased to introduce Paul Goldberger to you. In our community, he needs no introduction. In fact, in any community, he needs no introduction. As I said, he is a Pulitzer Prize-winning author. He was the Dean of Parsons. But most recently, because this is not yet out there in the public, we are very pleased to congratulate him on his Arts and Letters Award in Architecture from the American Academy of Arts and Letters. It's an extraordinary. And indeed, that prize, that award, is for Building Art, the Life and Work of Frank Gehry, who Paul interviewed at the Parsons Table very recently here. Frank Stella equally needs no introduction, in fact, I don't want to say too many things that you might get into in introducing him. So what I would like to do is have a round of applause for both Frank and for Paul so we can begin the conversation.
Thank you.
Oops. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much, Joel, and thanks to all of you for being here. We do interview in this series people with names other than Frank, but it's especially gratifying to me to have Frank Stella here, a painter who I've admired, I think, for my entire career, and whose work continues to grow in richness and complexity as time goes on. We were saying backstage before that his career has been like very few others in our time. He graduated from Princeton in the late 50s, came right to New York, began his life as a painter, was skillful enough and fortunate enough to receive recognition pretty early on, but he was the opposite of an early bloomer who faded. His career has just continued to develop with greater and greater levels of richness. I hope we will touch on each part of it. Frank also has on that iPad a number of slides which he can sort of call up at will if the technology is working correctly and bring into the conversation. Most of his work, some are of other things as well that have been influences that are of interest to him. It's rare, however, that we have the opportunity to talk to an artist sitting beneath one of his major works. Joel said earlier he was so appreciative of the Board of Trustees of the New School, not just for accepting this wonderful gift, but for finding the right place on campus for it. Given its size, we might say it was the only place on campus for it. But in fact, it's a wonderful place because it has enriched this auditorium hugely. It seems to me that in the short couple of months, really a few months it's been here, this room has taken on a whole new and richer kind of life that has only served to enhance the architecture, not in any way compete with it. But let's start, in fact, we'll go back in time in a few minutes. Frank, let's start, since it's here and we're here, talking a little bit about Deauville, this painting, how it initially came to be and then its second life, so to speak, here at the New School.
Well, I'm trying to think of Deauville. Of course, is a port town in the north in France, but it's a racetrack.
Right.
That's what's interesting about this. There was another painting similar to it, Agua Caliente, which was another racetrack in Mexico, and there was a third one, but I can't remember what it was. But this Deauville was interesting because it's a kind of landscape in a way. I mean, it's certainly doesn't look, I mean, it's obviously like a racetrack, and it's obviously has qualities like a landscape. But I think the thing that's most, to me anyway, is the somehow the color, the general atmosphere of the piece itself is has some of that quality of the landscape and the feeling in the seashore in, in France. And, you know, what's interesting about Deauville is that that's where the best two-year-olds in Europe come out every August. And it's pretty exciting.
Two-year-old horses, we
mean. Not babies.
Right, right. Okay.
Everybody knows what two-year-olds are talking
about. Yeah, well, just to be sure. Yeah, but I also...
You got to get ready for the Derby, yeah.
Right. That makes me want to jump ahead to something I was going to get to in a minute, but we'll do it right now, which is the fact that all of your paintings are titled, and the titles are often quite evocative and interesting, do not always appear to have a direct connection to the painting itself. Can you talk about that? Can you talk a little bit about how you title paintings and how and why?
Well, I mean, sometimes I think there's a very strong connection, and I have to admit, sometimes it's a stretch. Mm-hmm. But there's a reason, I think, for it beyond the actual title itself, is that I need at some point to keep working on something, maybe one painting or the group of paintings, for them to have an identity. Mm-hmm. I have to know who they are. And so they have to have a name. If they didn't really have a name, I'd have a hard time engaging with them.
Okay. But the name, early on, I mean, they were the black paintings.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, but that, again.
And which were sort of named as a group. But they were also named individually, right?
Yeah, they had all, I didn't name them the black paintings.
Oh, okay, right. Okay.
I gave each one a title.
Right.
But the best title I gave, I didn't give it to. Carl Andre gave it, which was The Marriage of Reason and Squalor.
Right.
That was a pretty good title.
Yes.
Not a bad painting, but I mean, right. Not that great. In that case, the title is better than the painting. But still.
I'm fascinated because actually the black paintings, which were very, very early, you named, those titles are phrases that come out of Nazi Germany, right?
And oh, God. It's not true. I mean, there are a
couple. It is not true, but they're German.
No, they're not. I don't think there are only two German titles out of
Arbach,
20.
Right.
Out of 20, okay. 22.
Okay.
And Arbeit, my Frei, wouldn't mind putting it to rest.
Okay. No, please,
because,
yeah.
You know, when the black paintings were shown for the first time together, which was, about 15 years later, in the 70s in Baltimore.
Okay, right.
People had talked a lot about the black paintings, but actually only four had been shown in New York, and it was in 1958. So there was a lot of expertise about the paintings and discussion of paintings that nobody had really seen. And when they were shown in Baltimore, it was an opening and very nice. And a woman came up to me, nice at that time, it seemed to me an elderly lady. And she came right up to me and
she
said,
"She was probably 40 or something like that."
No. She was unfortunately, she was obviously a survivor.
Oh, right,
and
right, okay.
And she said, "How do I know what side you're on?" And that was it. I took the title because of the obvious political implications of it.
Sure.
But because as a young man, and I'm not using the young man part as an excuse, but you can understand, I think, pretty easily how available that is to you when you're young, that what your parents tell you, and then the gruesome irony later on that work is going to free you
right.
when you're trying to be a bum.
Right. So, and you wanted to evoke some of the pain in those paintings, or did you not want to evoke the pain?
No, I don't think you can evoke anything personally with paintings.
Okay.
But you do what basically you want to do. But I mean, you make the painting try to basically stand on its own feet and go and be what the best or as direct as it can be as a visual expression. But the point of expression is that the expression is going to come almost totally from the viewers. So my expression or what I might be trying to express or my feeling about my own painting is very small compared to what actually happens.
Mm-hmm.
It's very important when you make it, but in the end, it's gone. I mean, it's not your expression anymore. So it's really hard to...
Because it's out in the world, and the life of the painting is how people experience it.
They're not going to give it... No one, the audience can't give it, or any single individuals can give it the feeling that I have about it.
Right.
And most of the feeling mm-hmm. comes from the making of it. And then the other part, the blackness, the dark, and how it ends up getting a title, that's, again... pretty circuitous.
But you said a moment ago something I want to come back to. It's not in the painting to evoke something.
Mm-hmm.
many, many years ago, you made a very famous observation early on in your career, what you see is what you see, which you're probably sick of defending and explaining at this point. But I want to dig into this idea of it can't evoke something. You cannot really mean that
it
you
can't
do not
evoke,
want it to
evoke something that I can explain.
Okay.
Because
I
don't know.
That's very different. Okay.
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 Yes. Because what it evokes with somebody else, that's their idea, not mine.
Right. Okay. And it cannot evoke in the viewer precisely what you felt and experienced as a painter creating it.
Yeah. Right. Especially if I could remember.
Right. But it can certainly sort of nudge or direct the viewer in a particular direction that you wish.
I think you're hinting,
even if it's not literally evoking what you experience.
Right, but I think you're hinting at something that I'm not sure it's of that interest to us now. But certainly in the 50s, the late 50s and the early 60s, all abstract painting was considered at the edge. There was a big question as to whether it could really evoke any feeling, and there was the other side of the picture, which was that the only real pictures that could evoke feeling and counted were mimetic efforts or representational painting.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But that's so far gone now that I don't know. I don't think anybody here would think it was bad that I was known, in order to put down in 1960 was that you were an academic painter.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
Nothing could be worse than that.
Right. No, I think you can rest assured that you will not go down in history as an academic painter. I think we're pretty safe from that at this point. But let's stay a little bit with this whole question of, in fact, you and abstract expressionism, because there was a lot of talk that you had kind of killed it off almost with your early work.
Not from me. I mean, and also
I'm not,
and
from,
not,
and, from
and
critics,
again,
from others, not from you.
Yeah, and it built up over time for mm-hmm. reasons that the people that first said it, evaporated pretty much or weren't around for that long. But why that sort of lingered or even grew, I'm not quite sure what the point was. It was convenient. But I don't, for them, I guess. I don't know why. I only guess that there was a kind of quite ferocious underlying hostility to abstract expressionism, which I never got mm-hmm. because I liked it so much. I mean, I didn't know the people that didn't like it. I thought, they don't like it because they don't know anything, so who cares about them? So I didn't see it that way. And it didn't make any sense on a larger art historical or intellectual level to say that there was something wrong with abstract expressionism. Because I don't know who, outside of Hilton Kramer, if anybody here remembers him, I don't know.
I remember him. Yes, so that's a whole
and
other.
And Emily Janauer. But I mean, there were a few. But I mean,
they were also.
I'll just say this and then forget about it. It wasn't about abstract expressionism. They were against the institutions that were supporting abstract expressionism.
Somewhat, I think. Yes.
They didn't really care about it that much. They didn't like the idea that the institutions, the people that ran everything, entertained that kind of art. Because if they ran the institutions, you certainly wouldn't see it there.
Yeah. I think that there's some truth to that. I think Hilton Kramer did sort of believe that there was a sort of heroic modern period, and that he was here to defend and protect against young artists who were stupid and didn't know anything and were trying to destroy it. But it always seemed to me that you were not doing that. You were merely, like all gifted artists, working your way through what had come before and then pushing through to do something that was your own.
I hope that's true. But the what's hard to understand is that the work that I was making, just say, okay, for the sake of it, the black paintings, I mean, they are so much more like Rothko and, say, Newman and that kind of painting, that side of abstract expressionist painting.
Yes.
And the other thing is, it happened so quickly, and I don't know why my paintings got involved in it, but it really was all about what happened right afterwards, which was pop art, and that was a threat, and that was a threat to the scene, and that seemed to be, maybe you could say it was a combination, but anyway, but there was nothing actually in my painting that was anything like against abstract expressionism, and I don't think I could have. You know, there's no way you could do it without abstract expressionism.
I think also, look, if you are a truly gifted artist, you can't just replicate what has come before. You have to kind of push yourself through it and come out somewhere on the other side, it would seem to me. You don't honor Franz Klein by continuing to make his paintings if you're a serious artist.
Yeah, it's true, but you know you can't get around it. I mean, somehow the level of making things and the it's hard to know when you're stopping, when imitation or working towards something, how you come out on the other side. Yeah, it's really pretty hard to predict.
Sure, sure, sure.
Because you know what you like, and you like it to be like that.
But you like it to be like that, and yet also, to some extent, your own, I would think. And is there a kind of struggle almost between?
Well, I think the part that ends up being your own is the part that's not so good. I mean,
this makes me think a little bit of, you know, Harold Bloom and the whole theory of the anxiety of influence, and how gifted artists often, either intentionally or not, kind of misread.
Yeah.
The work of their predecessors.
I think it, you can look at it another way. I mean, I don't know about the anxiety, but a painting that I like, and that I liked at the same time that I liked abstract expressionism, and when I was painting a lot when I was going to school, was the experience of going to the Philadelphia Museum. And as I remember it, at the top of the stairs at that time, there was the Roger van der Weyden crucifixion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, that was a great painting, and I wasn't planning on imitating that, but I was taken with it in a very strong way, which is that it represented something that never went away. There was a goal, if I were to make something like that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to get to that level. And whether you get there or not is not really so important, as long as you can recognize what it is. And I think that's it doesn't go away. And that had nothing to do with abstract expressionism, but of course it does. But but it's related to the kind of geometric painting before abstract expressionism. But in Roger van der Weyden, I could see the a connection or a way to get to abstract painting in the 20th century.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
It was perfectly obvious, to me anyway, and perfectly legitimate in a way. If that's what you liked, here's an example of what you can show, that this is what really does it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can get there, that's fine.
Mm-hmm. You're a painter who's always really, even though you're not an art historian by training and profession, who's always been, it seems to me, very deeply and profoundly involved in the history of art, and think a great deal about it, and thinking in very much as you just spoke of van der Leyden. I mean, Caravaggio, I think, has been an influence. I remember once many years ago, you may not remember this, seeing you at the Vermeer show at the National Gallery in Washington. Studying Vermeer with an incredible care and attention.
Yeah, I was probably trying to figure out if that guy could see the back of his head.
And to me, your work has always embodied the I think the critical principle that understanding and building on something is not the same as imitating it, and that influence is often at its most profound when it's not mimicry, but of a different sort.
Yeah, I can't argue with that. But one of the things about being involved with art history or having a sense, it has to do with, circumstance, no question about it. But, just by going away to school, at Phillips Academy, it had a real museum, small and terrific.
Yes.
And it was being brought up with the actual paintings there. Not reproductions. Mm-hmm. I mean, the physical reality of painting was, from the time I was 14 or 15 years old, was pretty manifest to me. And that is the feeling of being in a circumstance where you're certainly privileged, where you can see what you're interested in or something interests you, and upstairs, and you can go downstairs and try to imitate it or make it, mm-hmm. or do whatever you want. But you have the physical, you have the tools,
right.
The physical tools to make something like what you just saw.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a kind of privilege, I suppose it's a privilege, it's luck, but you can really relate to what you're trying to do.
Andover, Phillips Andover was very influential for you, wasn't it? I mean, it was that early in high school when you began to think of yourself as becoming a painter?
I wasn't thinking about becoming a painter because that didn't seem to be a very good idea. But I was pretty convinced that I liked doing it. And mm-hmm. my father would tell me, you can, if you became a optometrist, you could paint at night.
Right.
And you could pursue it. But, the truth of the matter was my mother was a painter. She mm-hmm. painted, and we painted together. We did things on the windows,
right.
Santa Claus at Christmas, and turkeys in oil paint on my bedroom window. And turkeys at Thanksgiving and bunnies at Easter. So we did a lot of that, and we made things. And she painted, she continued to paint all along. And my father was a pretty good painter, too, in the sense that in order to go to, he had to go to medical school.
He was a doctor, right?
Yeah, he was a gynecologist. Yeah. But in working his way into depression through medical school, he worked as a house painter. So I had painting on both sides. So I know it's sort of like a joke, but on the other hand, it was a physical reality, the material, mm-hmm. the idea that when I came to New York and people discovered the idea that what was incredible about advanced abstract paintings was its materiality.
Right.
That wasn't news to me.
You had been imbued with a sense of materiality from the beginning. Yeah.
Yes, yeah. I mean, not imbued. I mean, just it was there, so I didn't really think about it.
Right, right, right.
And I liked it. I guess that's the other thing. It's a little bit tricky. A lot of people, wash their hands after they get paint on them and stuff and clean up. And, it took a while for me to get used to that.
To washing or not washing?
to cleaning up, yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. And you went from Phillips Andover to Princeton.
Mm-hmm.
Andover, Princeton, not the normal CV of a painter, generally.
Not so untrue. I mean, there are quite a few, McLaughlin and Cleve Gray. I mean, there were a lot of people in those schools who painted. I mean, so there was a culture there. And the culture mm-hmm. at Andover, I mean, was pretty ferocious, actually, as far as contemporary painting went. The director, Bartlett Hayes, who loved everything in the student art show except my work. But he was a nice guy. But under his influence, it was Albers and then Hans Hoffman. He brought Hans Hoffman and helped publish his writing.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you think of Albers on one hand, the squares, and if you think of Hoffman, blocks and slabs of color. I mean, you have the, it's very German, but it's really the heart of 20th century abstraction.
Mm-hmm.
The more
mm-hmm.
formal, severe, and expressionist, lyrical painting. And so, if you have to have teachers, I mean, or something to aim for. I mean, they were pretty good. I mean, not just pretty good, but a very, very focused and strong and clear.
One of the things that was most striking as you moved beyond the early black paintings and the aluminum and copper series was as you began to shape the canvas in a certain way and cut notches out of it and get away from squares and rectangles, and then you got farther and farther away from squares and rectangles. Can we talk about that a little bit, about
yeah, we can.
Were,
I mean, but I don't, you don't get
doing
you
there?
Don't get far away from the rectangles.
Okay.
And I mean, if you imagine, I mean, rectangle, you can think of it another way. I mean, which is basically, you don't get away from planes, the physical planes that you need to create a surface, to make a surface that you work on. So the planarity, you can cut away from it, you can shape it. But usually, I mean, it took me a long time to get beyond just overlapping planes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I would say, you know, that's trying to get, you know, not, I haven't gone very far when you've done that, if you, because you're right there with Cézanne.
Mm-hmm,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you know, they used to make a big deal about being, getting beyond cubism. But it was at the time, it wasn't that easy. I mean, now you can get beyond cubism by not knowing what it is or what it is.
Well, we will get back to that. Is it fair to say, though, that you've been sort of exploring using two-dimensional surfaces to try to explore three-dimensional space in some way?
Well,
without actually making true three-dimensional things, which you did much later, but
yeah,
that's another matter.
I don't know. Right from the beginning, to tell you the truth, mm-hmm, I mean, there, you know, it gets tricky because in the end, geometry plays a very big role in how you think about things and certainly about planes and some kind, certain kinds of how you think about space. But I mean, it's kind of difficult because you're so glib about two dimensions. Because, you know, two dimensions has there no real reality. It's a really, I hate to say this, an abstraction.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I wouldn't know exactly how to do it, but I would say that the emphasis is on surfaces, on the surface that you work on, and then the delimitation, you know, the description of the surface that you work on, and delimiting it, and then adding surfaces, and then
mm-hmm,
that's the only way I could think about it then. But now, if you take a view that's essentially spherical, a kind of version of a sculptural view of things, that seems to change it. I mean, for me, when you said squares and rectangles, that's true. When you're working with straight line, once you introduce the curve, I mean, you can keep a curve basically on a two-dimensional surface, so to speak. But what the curves just introduce an obvious way of changing the space that's available to you.
Although you began by taking notches and corners and destroying the orthogonal nature of the canvas.
First, well, but actually that's true, but that wasn't what I was really looking at when
okay.
I did that. That was because I was looking for a pattern.
Mm-hmm.
And so to make the stripes following the edges weren't really getting that interesting, and the beat, the rhythm that you could get by making a jog,
mm-hmm,
seemed a little bit more interesting.
Which it is.
Well, I don't
but,
know how interesting.
But it sort of well, it's interesting that you use the word interesting, actually.
It wasn't my word. It was Bill Seitz, my teacher, William Seitz.
Okay, what did he say? How did he use it?
When your painting was pretty boring, he'd say, oh, that's interesting. And you knew it. You knew how boring it was.
Okay. I always used to tell students that interesting was the word you used when you didn't know what else to say, actually. But
yeah, I think interesting is a tough word, but how about holds your interest? That seems to be something else.
It sounds more serious, even if it isn't actually fundamentally different as a statement, I think. Maybe a better way to take this whole idea, though, of two dimensions, three dimensions, is I always feel in your work that all of it, whether two-dimensional or whether it's a work in relief of some kind, like when the planes began to pull out of the canvas, or even if it's just two-dimensional, it all somehow affects your perception of space. I feel I'm reading space in it somehow, somewhere. But maybe that's just me with an architect's bias. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what you read, but I mean, it's still, I don't know. I mean, I think that there's space there. You read it spatially, but I find it hard in the end to get away, or it can be as complicated as it can get in a way, but I'm always, seem to me, to be chasing an image.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to, and it's always, excuse me, more interesting when you have a number of images that coalesce.
Uh-huh.
And that's when things start to happen. And that's when you can get different level, different reactions about the space and different reactions about the forms.
Okay.
So, and in the end, that's just another way of saying that, you know, you need a sense of vitality and activity. And maybe you need narration. Or in a sense that there is something going on, a story being told,
right,
by the elements.
And it's truly by the elements. You don't think, to go back to the question about title, you don't think of the title as part of the narration, do you?
No. The title is like the title of the book, like War and Peace, right?
Right. Okay. Well, War and Peace is part of the narration, I suppose. It's sort of about war and peace, but. Let's talk a little bit about the world of New York you came into in the 50s. You've touched on it a little bit, and the 60s. You've been part of the New York art scene for six decades, which is
I know,
amazing.
It's pretty embarrassing.
I don't know. I think it's actually pretty triumphant to be, you know, still still here, still doing it, still working, still producing, still doing important work that is also still developing and different from what you had done before.
Is there anything you can say
about the nature of the world of painting in New York today as opposed to some of the other decades you've lived through?
Well, when I came here and I took a place on Eldridge Street, and I was working there, and I came up, it is kind of a full circle. I mean, it was to 12th Street and down in the mm-hmm. basement there where Steve Green had was giving a class, and we went out for a beer afterwards, and I met Richard Meyer, who was in the class, and we became friends, and he came to my studio later on and was making paint. You got into a kind of scene in which you had friends and you were doing the same thing. So it was pretty normal in a way.
The city seemed much smaller, didn't it?
Yeah, it was smaller. I mean, now you don't have to go to the Chinese restaurants all the time after the opening.
Mm-hmm. But could your career begin now? Could a career like yours happen? You know, the essay he wrote for the big retrospective of your work that was at the Whitney a year and a half ago. Remember, Adam Weinberg, the director of the Whitney, wrote that you entered the New York art scene as a mature painter. Lovely thing, I guess, to have said.
Yeah, I mean, it's like Ted Williams came up in 1941 as a mature hitter.
Well, it's not so bad to be compared to Ted Williams.
I guess I shouldn't have jumped off like that. What was the point? That I was mature?
The point, I was quoting I wanted to say, can a career like yours that begins with recognition is not spoiled by that recognition, but in a way nurtured by it, and keeps going and keeps developing in new ways decade by decade. Can one imagine a career like that existing now?
Yes.
Good.
I hope
the answer is yes, because it would be good for the future of painting, but I just don't know.
So I think there's always a ton of talent out there.
Mm-hmm.
And talent doesn't go all the way, and it's hard to describe. But I think that it, the combination of luck and talent, but wanting to do it. I mean, I think, you know, the main thing is, I don't think it's so important. I mean, I never met any particularly good artist who was much interested in his career. I mean, they were always interested in what they did. Mm-hmm. I mean, how good their paintings were, you know. And we talked about, and in the 60s, when you knew everybody, or
right.
was smaller, you went to people's studios, and that was that seems to not be such a big thing anymore. Although that I can't really say that, because I'm not living in Bushwick. So.
That's kind of my question. I mean, is the world of Bushwick, how similar do you think the world of Bushwick is to the world of 12th Street back then?
Yeah. I think it's probably pretty much the same,
mm-hmm.
except I would say, and I'm not sure of this, because I mean I can imagine what the scene is and like that, but the scene on 12th Street, or the 10th Street we used to call it,
right,
for some reason,
right.
was very, very closely linked to the institutions,
mm-hmm.
To the institutions that were teaching, to the schools, and to the museums.
Mm-hmm.
And that was because, there weren't that many people who wanted to be artists, and they were focused on the places where you could see art all the time, and that was what they were involved in.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a kind of closeness, whether you wanted it or not, to the... I mean, you could find your friends at the Museum of Modern Art on Saturday.
Right, right.
And people would be there.
Right, right, and just hang out. There. Yeah, yeah. The economics, of course, were very different. I mean,
mm-hmm.
even a successful painter's work did not sell for vast, untold jillions of dollars.
Right. So I was successful in 59 or something like that, but I didn't get to zero until 1968.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then I started to make money.
Right, right.
But Leo carried me.
Right, right. In other words, you were successful in 1959, but you actually were not showing a profit. You were still in the black, in the red.
I still owed money. Yes.
Right, right, right.
But I wasn't paying interest.
Right, but it cost more to maintain your life than you made from your paintings.
Yes, yeah.
Even
sure.
though
yeah.
you were, for a young mm-hmm. painter,
and
successful.
And I certainly wasn't the only one.
Right, 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 right. I mean, the how different is the nature of success, would you say, right now? I mean, the celebrity culture and things like that, which...
You know, I don't know. It's yeah. really impossible to measure. I mean, as mm-hmm. far as I can say, when Eddie Fisher came into the Cedar Bar with Elizabeth Taylor, you know, I nearly passed out, so I mean, I can't imagine any celebrities are anywhere near as interesting as, you know.
You were there when Eddie Fisher
well,
came
one
in?
One night when they came in, yeah, yeah.
Ah, okay.
I mean, the only, you know, the only redeeming feature was that Eddie Fisher was shorter than I was.
You didn't have Elizabeth Taylor, he did.
Well, no, I didn't care.
Taylor.
I mean,
right, okay.
it was about my stature as a
right,
man.
Right,
not
right,
by
right, right.
woman who was at my arm. Yeah.
Right, right, right. That's a great story.
Anyway, there was hope anyway for
right,
me.
Right, right, right.
If Eddie could do it, well.
That's a wonderful story. I had not known that. I mentioned the Whitney retrospective a moment ago.
Mm-hmm.
which I thought was a wonderful show, and the fifth floor of the New Whitney looked just breathtaking. I know you were very involved in the installation of it. I want to talk about that for a moment because I was fascinated by it. It was a not fully chronological hanging, as is customary with a large retrospective. What were you doing in the unusual juxtapositions? I thought a lot of them were very, very successful, and it was a wonderful alternative to a purely chronological hanging. Although I remember Roberta Smith in the New York Times referred to it as alternately dazzling, oppressive, and nuts.
Is that Roberta Smith?
That was Roberta, right, whatever. I say that not to agree with her, because as I said, I loved it, but just to ask you, what were you working with and trying to do in the somewhat unusual hanging in that
Actually,
show?
Actually, you know, I like to think that I knew what I was doing. I mean, and I had an idea and I had a plan. But, I mean, in the end, you have to work with other people. And so the curator's Adam, there's a kind of involvement, but Annabelle Feldorf, I mean, mm-hmm. you know, it actually was an architectural problem.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
it's an open mm-hmm. space, okay?
Yeah.
So it's the chronology doesn't quite work when you would have to tailor the space to the chronology.
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes funny because, I mean, at the end, everything would be little rooms in the beginning, and then little larger rooms, and then bigger spaces at the end. Right?
Just to play the devil's advocate here, what would be wrong with that?
It's like you're going, I don't want to say it, you know, it's like you're being led to an event.
Mm-hmm.
I won't say what event it is, but...
Right.
You have to have some feeling for the pieces and how would they look like with each other. And so mm-hmm. some pieces, it's a kind of fantasy, I suppose, but there is a kind of dialogue. And some things, it was nice to see early paintings relate to some paintings a little bit later.
Yeah, no, that's what I found absolutely fascinating about it. It was not the easy, like, let's take a walk through Frank Stella's life.
But
old Stella talking to young Stella, talking to middle-aged Stella, and so forth.
Well, there are too many Stellas there. But the idea is that really, because it was an open space, there are advantages to open spaces
mm-hmm,
when
mm-hmm.
it's not a room. You can see from one place to another, and you can turn around and look back, and you have the idea of choices and routes, so that the chronology doesn't matter too much. You could walk through the middle, turn right, turn left, and at each place you could see more than just what you're looking at here. You could see it in relation to something there, somewhere else.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and I mean, I think that was the, and finding the right rhythm for that was the sort of, what makes it work.
So you were very conscious of vistas sort of across
the
galleries.
The main thing is being able to turn around
mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
See where you came from.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What would you have done if it were not the Whitney, but the Guggenheim doing that show? How do you think you would have installed it?
I don't know. I think I would have done it pretty much the same way. So it wouldn't be necessarily chronological. There's plenty of ways you could deal with it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
I mean,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be afraid of it.
Yeah. No, I would have. It would have been fascinating to see you engage with the Guggenheim because you have such an architectural sensibility.
Yeah, actually, things like
But.
You know, something like the Guggenheim is interesting, not because, it is the space it is, but I love Frank Lloyd Wright so much. I mean, I'd be thrilled to somehow work in the Guggenheim.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
I remember when I first came, I was stunned when I went to the top, and you go to the Guggenheim, and then it was closed off because the restorers wanted the best light underneath the
big dome.
And you couldn't show
You couldn't
painting.
Go all the way up the ramp. Yeah.
I was one of the early protesters.
Ah, good. Well, maybe we partly have you to thank for the fact that it's open the rest of the way. But you've always been, your whole career, very interested in architecture, I know, and
It's the same thing that I said about going to school. It was lucky, the place that I went. And, you know, I don't know how you can say you're lucky to be born in Malden, Massachusetts, but the fact was that that was the home of Converse Rubber Company, and Mr. Converse built the library in Malden, Massachusetts, with H.H. Richardson.
Right, right.
And it's a fantastic, wonderful, lovely, I don't, you can't say enough about it, as there are other libraries and other buildings that he made. I mean, he's a pretty underappreciated.
Oh, Richardson was one of the greatest architects who's ever lived,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's it. And the detail and the feeling in there for the materials, the way it was and everything, just being in there and being in there at an age when you just absorbed it. I mean, it wasn't about architecture or about anything. It was just the physical reality and the attractiveness of the space.
So you just sort of came to it viscerally, really.
Yeah, I liked it. I think I liked the detail. I liked the quality of the wood, and I remember the spiral. I mean, you know, when you're small or something, but a spiral staircase. I'd never seen a spiral staircase before.
Mm-hmm.
But this spiral staircase was probably cast iron, but it had a lot of holes in it filled with glass. And that was, I didn't realize that, but I think it was a fairly common thing in the late 19th century, the combination of glass and steel. And it was you know, and it let the light in and everything.
Remember Penn Station, the big
Anyway, so
panel,
that was, it was always there. And we had a nice house, too, with very good woodwork.
But you've designed some things over the years that have not been built, but that were actual real architectural projects. And I know that one of them, Philip Johnson, who was always willing to crib from talented people, said was the major influence in the little building he built at the entrance to the glass house
that he
called the Monster.
Yeah.
Can we talk about that a little bit? I mean, that...
Well, Phil, you know that Philip is such a... I don't know, such a difficult character in sort of way, but when it was part of the thing about being coming to New York, being involved with the museum and everything, and it was so, I mean, I never met anybody, I don't think it was easier to get along with than Philip. And so he was always encouraging, he was always, and I don't think it was, you know, it didn't have anything, I wasn't that special in any way, but I mean, he was... It was just, he was, I'm back to interested again. He was always interested in what you were doing.
Right.
He saw that, I gave him the model, the model for that. And it was part of a series of buildings that, a group of buildings that I was doing for a project in Dresden.
Right.
And he took that, and he said, we were having a very hard time with the engineers and the architects and everybody worrying about the compound curves.
Mm-hmm,
I mean, nowadays, nobody cares about that much anymore at all. But anyway, that was it, and he said, we'll build that. And so he took that, and he built it.
Right, right.
With screening.
So it is pretty close to your design.
Yeah, it is... as close as you can get. He cut the holes in it. I only made it as a solid, so I can't complain about that.
I
only made the exterior,
and then
he made the interior.
Right. Which is still there to be seen by anybody who visits Johnson's house. But he was somebody who had a sort of limitless appetite for engagement with talented, articulate people. He would, anybody who was smart and creative and could talk well, he wanted essentially, and often supported in their careers.
Well, too. I mean, it was pretty impressive. I mean, but again, it goes back to what's not so true now. I mean, what a locus the Museum of Modern Art was at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, he was an incredible expression of that.
Right. He was also a great collector of your. He and David Whitney were major collectors of your work. Yeah, and I know there are quite a number of important paintings that are still there in that house.
Yeah. Well, also that was a. I don't remember when it began, but we used to. You would be invited to the house, but I remember the first time we were invited to visit the mausoleum of the underground.
The art gallery. The underground art gallery.
I mean, I have to say, I was about as shocked as you could be. I mean, it seemed crazy.
Why did it seem crazy?
I don't know. It was an underground bunker, and it had a lot of paintings that were walls that you moved back and forth. It seemed incredibly pointless. But I like it now. I mean, it
a lot of your paintings. A lot of your paintings are on those walls that move back and forth. But he would describe it as having been influenced by Sir John Soane's museum in London and the panels that opened like doors that had, you know, layers of paintings.
Right. Well, I didn't know about that.
Yeah, as a way of getting more paintings into a room than you could fit on four walls. In other words, sort of combining the idea of the storage facility with the idea of the gallery.
I think it's okay, but it has the basic limit of the storage facility, which is no light.
Yeah, true. Yeah, you cannot see anything in natural light there. That's right. That's true, which is, you know, challenging in some ways. We're going to turn in a moment, because we have a lot of interesting questions, so we're going to turn to your part of the conversation. We have several that have been sent by email, and I think others can be sent. But before we do, Frank, do you want to show some of the images you brought and discuss them?
How am I going to do that?
I think they're supposed to be accessible on this iPad. Let's see if it works. Oops, if it works the way it's supposed to. There we are.
Okay.
So I think if you just touch any one of them, it will come up. And if you want to discuss a couple of them before we have some questions, please do. Let's see. Mm-hmm. You can also see it there if it's working properly.
Hit it again. It works great on here.
We have to reconnect this. Okay. Ah.
What a farce.
All right. Well, you see, you've got a couple of very tech savvy people here. Okay. Is it? It's definitely on there now. There we are. Okay, good. Good, it's working. And you can see it right there as well.
Yeah, okay. So that's a self-portrait of my mother.
Great.
And that's Andover. And that's my father. And that's me. Mm-hmm. And okay. It's hopeless.
Are you trying to get another one up or
okay. And that's me again. Okay, so that's the space. Okay, that's a hat. It's called a soaker.
Right.
And you put that in the water, and then you pull it over your head, and then it keeps you from getting sunstroke and everything. But if you take that and twist it, there's no end to what you can do with it. It's the basic idea of a spiral. And you cut it out, and then you can turn it. And that went from planar to something that was less like that was a plane cut out of a sheet of paper or a sheet of foam. Mm-hmm. But anyway, that's how things changed in a basic way. And what you don't see how it changed, because I don't have, I can't find any other pictures, is that that's still the surface of the hat, the flat hat. It's still the laterals, the things that spring out. If you give them a curvature, like on the wing of an airplane, then all of a sudden things start to happen, and the geometry gets very complicated, and you have a lot of things open up for you.
Mm-hmm. Good. Any others you want to show? Or
no, that's okay. No.
Okay, good. Up to you. Yeah. Because we have a lot of interesting questions here as well. So I'm going to start with one that actually gets away from art, but we'll come back to it, because it's about a subject that interests me as well. I read that you were a passionate fan of road racing since the late 1970s. I wonder if how this might have influenced your work from the 1980s and with the use of the flexicurve, which has been an important instrument in designing automotive curves at the time.
I became a fan of basically motor racing formula. I started out in Formula 2 and graduated to Formula 1 as a fan. But mm-hmm. I met a driver, Sam Posey, and he brought a model to me. Mm-hmm. Because, Leo had sent him to me to design this model to make to paint a car, paint a BMW for Le Mans.
You did paint a BMW.
I didn't paint it myself, but I made the design.
Right.
And actually, it was a lot of graph paper. We cut out all the pieces and everything. It took a long time actually papering the car with graph paper, but you could do that with Photoshop now, probably in about 10 minutes. But anyway, it was painted by professional car painters in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot what the point was.
The question was about whether
the influence
you in any way.
There are two things. There's the obvious technical things that go on. I mean, the machinery and everything is quite dramatic, the way they spend money and what they do and how they test. And then the development of carbon fiber, which mm-hmm. was great because it made things a lot safer and a lot more interesting. That was really interesting. And then the other thing is you do go on the course, and not on the Formula One course there, but it as a result of that, I was sent to driving school. So you learn a little bit about driving and about driving at speed. And it does change the way you see things a little bit, and it's just another way of seeing that it is interesting. I mean, the way things change.
Do you still?
But it's a little repetitive.
Yeah.
You know, you go around and around and around.
Do you still?
But it's not repetitive because
right.
You have to pay attention.
Do you still do race driving?
I don't do race driving. I only go to driving school. To make up for not going to art school.
Probably much more useful, right? Okay. Good, thank you. Now a question that goes back more directly to art. What provoked the transition from your austere, minimalist, geometric approach to the tumble and jumble of your late work? If you would agree to describe it that way or not.
I don't mind that.
Okay, good, good, okay.
It's then, okay. But then, the change is actually, the change started in the end, it's all about geometry, as they say.
Mm-hmm.
And so the early pieces, the geometry was rather simple and linear. And about 1965, the geometry changed a little bit, although it was a fairly simple change. If I could, it's probably in here, but I can't find it.
We could try. You want me to try, or
I don't know.
See if we can get this stuff back on again? Let's see.
I can't see the pictures get too small. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I can describe it. Leave that one on. That's good.
Okay. All right.
The issue is simple. The basic stripe paintings sort of have a simple geometry which relates to the rectangle. And there's a very famous, there are a lot of them anyway, a famous Malevich painting, which is easy to describe. It's a rectangle. I think it's the rectangle is actually black. And then there's a triangle that is laid over the top of it. It's a blue triangle. And so the rectangle is here, the triangle's there. That's what amounts to another kind of very conventional geometry in which you are basically making a kind of design decision. So this triangle, how does this triangle relate to the rectangle? And you lay it over part of it. And I did the same thing, but I was working on it in a way that by following the triangle and the rectangle or square, and tracing on the outside of it, I made it so that there was another element of the design, not just the flat triangle and the flat rectangle. There was an outline around the triangle, and that pushed itself into the rectangle. And the idea was that you could create a tension with the shaped canvas and have it so that it's not lying on top of each other. So I hate to use this word, that one form is penetrating the other, and so the point of that is that creates a kind of tension. It's not just the idea of it running into the other thing. It's what sometimes what the engineers talk about. It gives the an optical version of, say, spring loading. So you feel that even though you have a triangle going into the rectangle, it can be expelled, and that there's actually an activity going on, even though the geometry is flat and linear. And so that is the beginning of the change of the way of thinking about things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it just continued from there and continued to develop, is what you're saying, right? And do you view it as a kind of straight line of development? Or
no. No. Because I like the... those were called the irregular polygons, I worked on that for about a year and a half when I had them, and then I couldn't go anywhere with it. And so I gave up, sort of reluctantly, and then I was working on other things, the protractors, and then I went back to working on things that were somewhat similar in the, say, the Polish village pieces.
Yes, right.
That was tough because the... in a way, they were interesting, the different planes, a lot of pieces and things like that. But actually, that was way more conventional, and actually the irregular polygons were still, in a sense, more radical, more interesting. And I was still looking for that something that wasn't about relating parts. In that picture that you took away.
I didn't take it. It sort of
took
itself
away.
Disappeared. Yes.
Okay, anyway, that's the same idea in a funny way from the irregular polygon, because that's the hat and we showed, and that's the hat twisted. And in that sculpture, that has the twist and everything. But with the twist, it's great, or I like it anyway. But you also have the sense of part of it that makes it work. I mean, it's aluminum and it's strong and but it has the feeling, the movement and the twist has the feeling that it could spring back, it could open up, and then and so that's what motivates it.
But in every case, at every phase, you were really just sort of diving into geometry as a almost organic thing, trying to just explore it and live
well,
it.
I suppose. I mean, in the end, there's, it has to stay together, it has to have movement, but then, at a certain point, the topology, there's the linear description of the geometry, and then there's the actual description of the surfaces. And the surface is what the painter works on. He's always painting on something. And so if the surfaces are already interesting, it's pretty challenging to paint on them or, you know, to work as a painter on the surface that's already probably more interesting than what you're going to do to
mm-hmm,
it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Two questions ask about a different type of influence, which you probably, well, let's see how you answer it. One of them is, can artists keep themselves separate from politics, or does art necessarily respond to political climates? And another somewhat similar question asked, what were historic events that influenced you as you created your art?
Well, I mean, the political issue is fairly tricky because it can be fatal. Mm-hmm. So that, I mean, and the history of modernism wasn't that great in that sense. But I'm not sure what the question is about what the politics does. I mean, I don't think you necessarily, although in some cases, certainly in Russia, I mean, in a lot of places, but it's not, I mean, and also if you take artists broadly, I mean, the intellectual elite of the artists and everything are often, you know, pretty good targets.
Right. I think the questioner was really getting at, is art created independent of politics? Can it be? Should it be? Is yours created independent of politics? And so forth.
I think it is in the end. I mean, because if mm-hmm. in fact, if politics makes the institutions, I'm not sure, because the politics changes and the institutions have a stronger and longer life than most of the political.
But that's the politics of art and institutions as opposed to the politics of politics, right?
But the politics, I don't know, as I see it anyway, the politics of politics have some influence on the institutions, but mm-hmm. at some point, the institutions manage usually to survive them because the politics drives itself somewhat like the cat chasing its tail.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I'm not so interested in politics.
Right.
Except when they ask me to give them money or make a poster or like that. So I take a minimal interest in it.
Well, I mean, you could say, in other words, you're interested as a citizen, but not necessarily as an artist.
Yes. Okay, that's a good way of putting it.
Right,
yeah.
Okay.
I do my job, yeah.
Right, okay. I can't resist asking this one. I don't know who it comes from, but what do you make of critics? How do you deal with critics?
What critics?
The questioner does not specify, so I will leave it to you to respond in any way you wish.
The question about critics, but do journalists count as critics?
You can say critics and journalists and then respond any way you want, okay?
All right.
You can use this question as a launch pad for anything at all you want to say.
No, okay. In general, be it criticism or journalism, I think you live with it. And I mean, I don't see a real alternative. I mean, it would be nicer, but criticism would be only one of the things that would need to be better to make life better for artists or for anybody. Mm-hmm. So it's a reality that that you're born into, and you leave it when you leave it. But it'll, I assume it'll persist. I used to like to read criticism or to read what people wrote, but you know that it's hard to believe that you talk about a long career. Mm-hmm. You can have a career so long that you don't read it anymore.
Right.
I find it a little weird.
But there was a lot of writing that appeared at the time of the Big Whitney retrospective, right? That mm-hmm. sort of looked at, and I did find, I was sort of puzzled by some of it in that Some of it sort
okay,
of...
Okay, tell me. I don't remember it that
well. Well, I look back at some of it just as I was thinking about tonight, and a couple of critics sort of talked about the length of your career, but almost they couldn't handle the notion that there hadn't been a lot of ups and downs. So they seemed to sort of create a lot of, you know, this great, brilliant, amazing early period, and then work that
period.
I thought was actually received pretty well at the time. In the middle, they sort of now say, oh, it was really more of a valley and so forth, as if to create a narrative that was more interesting than a straight line.
I have to say about criticism that you react different ways, but actually when we keep talking about the Whitney show and everything, and, you know, to my, I don't know how to say it, amazement or whatever. Anyway, it so happens that today I stopped on the way home since I had to get, and I went to the Whitney Annual.
Oh, yeah, but, yeah, right.
I feel I should get a medal. But anyway, it was, you know, it was interesting.
All right, okay. Okay, well, this gets us right into another question, which was about where you think contemporary art is going right now. So you've set it up yourself.
Yeah, I think, and I would say it's really nice to be surprised. I mean, it's really obvious that a lot of stuff is... Basically, I couldn't find anything I don't like, which is to say, not to say that I was very interested in. I mean, because it's very hard with art if you're really going to say, oh, I really don't like that. I mean, you'd have to say there's something meretricious about it or something. You know, this guy is really a bad guy and this is a bad idea. And you know, some of it's borderline. I mean, there probably are some bad ideas. But, like, say the most common idea that comes up about painting of things, is it pornography? Or mm-hmm. Is it art? Those kind of essentially trivial questions.
Right.
But anyway, that kind of thing. But you see ability and things that you like, and you see it done in a way that, you know, I wouldn't do it that way because it seems to me grotesquely bad taste. But then I liked it. Partly because I didn't do it, and I couldn't be blamed for it. So, you know, there are a lot of possibilities. And the other thing is, at a certain point, you know, I find some things, you know, a little quicker, a little sense of a little bit more. Talent's a funny word because it doesn't really do it. But I like things with have a little more. Touch to them, and they're not. I mean, the heavy-handed stuff. I don't know, but I guess I can talk about other artists.
Absolutely.
All right. Okay.
Ahead.
So a perfect example of how difficult it is to tell the difference between heavy-handed and touch is I really like Julian Schnabel's work, and it would be easy to describe it as heavy-handed, but actually that would be totally wrong. What's really good about it is the lightness of the touch. So that's the best example I can give.
And whether this is, I mean, your sensibility is such, I think, that you clearly like a lot of art that is very different from your own, too.
Right, but put the Whitney Annual to rest.
Yeah.
So what artist did I like best in the Whitney
Annual?
Larry Bell.
Larry Bell, who is, right.
And it was by far, I mean... But that's what I like. I mean, I didn't like it because it was the best piece, but it seemed like, I don't know, really. It was certainly, you know, it was beautiful there compared to what I'd seen before when I looked over the railing. Anyway, I loved it, that piece. But I liked other pieces.
Does physical beauty mean what it once did in art?
I don't know. I mean, one of the interesting, actually, not bad to say about the Whitney Annual. You could say that... you know, there's a lot of bad art, but by meaning deliberately bad art, so that they're trying to prove how not beautiful they can be, and they're very successful. But, but you know, that raises the question, I mean, as to, I mean, you know, oh boy, I finally ran out of names. But anyway, Picabia, okay? Mm-hmm. But it's not the reality is bad art is not a new idea.
Right.
And the question is, you can't have bad art deliberately made, or can you? I mean, that's it. I mean, what's called naive art and everything, that's not bad art. It's actually, it's almost always quite nice. But I think there's a difference. All I wanted to say is the difference between being wrong and being bad. Okay? Something can be
Could you call it perhaps cynical art?
No, it's not interesting enough to be enough touch.
Where would you
maybe,
put...
Maybe, I don't know.
I'm going to ask, since we talked about it for a moment backstage, where on that continuum, say, would you put a piece of art that was just in the news today, which is the Jeff Koons stuff for Louis Vuitton, those bags?
Well, I don't. When they send me a bag, I'll let you know.
Okay. All right, that's maybe as good an answer as there could be, but... is there a line between art and fashion and merchandising that has ceased to exist today?
I don't think so. I mean, okay. I mean, I think it was always. I mean, I think I don't know anything about fashion really, and everything. But I can't believe that all of the development of fashion, even over just in the 20th century. I mean, fashion wasn't great in the beginning of the century in Paris, just because the influence of the artist and the art scene and the fashion scene is always symbiotic.
They've always been, exactly.
Yeah. But, I mean, look at dance and costumes and stage mm-hmm. design. And mm-hmm. Actually, that was one of the things. A lot of the things that I saw at the Whitney, I thought would be terrific as stage design, sort of like Dracula. But anyway.
Good. That may be a wonderful note on which to conclude with the word Dracula. Frank, thank you very, very much for being here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That was great. Absolutely wonderful. Thank you all again. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm.